Well, stand to your feet for a moment and let's go before the Lord. And because you, like Dr. Becker said, you haven't come to hear from a man. Never go to church to hear from a man or a woman. Go to church to hear from God. God wants to speak to you. And one of the foolish things that we pastors think is I've got to say something just exactly the right way. It's not how I say it, whether it's the right way or wrong way. Of course, it is important that I say truth. But it is really what God deposits in your heart during the course of the Word of God being spoken. That's when you've heard from the Lord, because the teacher is the Holy Spirit. So, Holy Spirit, we come in the name of Jesus, and we just thank you, Father, for a great move of your Spirit in our hearts and our lives this night. We thank you, Father, that we can come and trust that the teaching tonight is not of a man or a woman, our ideologies or philosophies of human thinking. But Father, we come tonight knowing that the teacher of the church is the Holy Spirit. Welcome, Holy Spirit. Touch us, heal us, strengthen us, encourage us, guide us, guard us, direct us, motivate us to be all that you would have us to be and do, and God will give you the praise. And as you bless us this night, Lord, we would ask that you bless everybody that's in the Inland Empire as well as around the planet that are preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're our brothers and our sisters. They may do church differently than us, but Lord, that's not about how you do church. It's about how your heart is washed by the blood of the Lord. And we thank you, God, for our brothers and sisters, our Baptist brothers and Lutherans and Methodists, Episcopalian, Charismatics, and Pentecostals. We thank you for Calvary Chapels and Harvest, Oak Valley and Oasis, Inland Christian Center. We thank you, Father, for the great churches like, if you will, Emmanuel Baptist and Trinity. And we thank you for Ecclesia and the great churches that are all over this valley preaching the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. We don't see ourselves as better than them. We see ourselves as co-laborers, workers together in one field, building one kingdom, and that's yours, the kingdom of God. Be honored in this house as there as well as in theirs, and we'll give you the praise and glory in Jesus' mighty name. We're all in agreement. We all say with a great big shout, amen. Amen. Go ahead, take your seat, get your Bible or get your electronic device, turn it on, and but make sure you know the difference between a electronic device is really kind of interesting. You have to turn that down so the sound doesn't bother the people next to you. And the Word of God, you wait for it to the sound to come louder as you take from your Bible. It's just you waiting for the Word of God to be spoken to you out of the Bible. And so I found it exciting. Don't cheat on God. No texting to your friends. I want you to concentrate in the Word of the Lord, because what we're going to do is we're going to continue and this wonderful subject called Profound Words of Jesus. And this is part number 8. I can't even imagine we've done 8 parts on this. We've been in Matthew, the 10th chapter, for the last 3 parts. And I found them fascinating as I look at it. I actually started in the middle of the 10th chapter and then went to the end of the 10th chapter. And now I'm coming to the beginning of the 10th chapter. Beginning of the 10th chapter actually starts in the 9th chapter, where Jesus is talking to his disciples. He's making a statement to his disciples. In fact, for those of you that are in here, I want you to hear what I'm going to say. This is actually the first missionary journey in the New Testament, is what takes place in Matthew, the 10th chapter. And Jesus is instructing his disciples on how to go out and do things and what he expects. And I think it's fascinating for all of us to look at this because, you know, as a Christian, sometimes we don't know what Jesus wants from us. We don't know what he expects of us. You know, we become a person that is born again. And like a lot of people that are born again, they think that's all there is. That's, you know, there's nothing else required of them. There's nothing else to do. I've attained what the highest position I could ever be at, which is very true. But yet at the same time, God didn't take you to heaven. He left you here because there's something he expects from you and there's something he wants you to do. And most people don't understand there's a process that takes place as we're Christians. We can be very, you know, new and not understand anything. But the more you get, the more you're going to get a hold of the Word of God, the more the Word of God is going to become alive on the inside of you, becomes what you do, becomes your heartbeat, becomes who you are. You now no longer function by what you think or what the world tells you. You start to function and operate and make decisions and choices based on what the Word of God has to say. And that's so important for us, because your choices are going to take you somewhere. Let me say it again. Your choices are going to take you somewhere. Where you choose is where you're going to end up. You are a product, as I've said before to you in the past many times, you're a product of your choices today. And the more great choices you make, the more great results there'll be in your life. If you don't know how to make the right choices, and you don't know what the choices are that you are to make, then what you'll do is just follow the rest of the world. Call yourself a Christian. Can hardly wait until heaven comes, but you're a bit afraid of that. And then you find yourself never doing anything, never receiving anything from God. So what we do is we like to come together each time at this church, which I think is fascinating, that we don't just, play church. We don't do just traditional ceremonial rituals. We come to church and we always break the Word of God open. And we always come into a place where we get to hear the things that God wants for us, desires of us, and cares for us and expects of us, so that we can operate His way. Why would I want to operate His way? Because when I operate His way, I get blessed. When I operate my way, I find myself in trouble. When I operate according to what other people do, my family, relatives, what other people think, even my closest relatives, fathers, mothers in the past, if whatever they said to me, can I tell you something? If it wasn't of God, I shouldn't even be operating in that mode. So many times we find ourselves following people, making choices based on what they said, instead of the real leader of our church, who's God, real leader of our life, who's God. Somebody ought to give me a great big amen. And so tonight, what we're doing is we're just simply having Bible study. I love that. Debbie and I, when we first got married, first time I ever laid my eyes on her, we were just in this little Bible study. And I saw her across the room. And she was with a good-looking girl. And I was happy to find that the other good-looking girl was already married. So I got my eyes off her immediately and checked Debbie out. And she was single, and I thought she was good looking, and I was thrilled to take a look at Debbie. We were in a Bible study, just a simple home Bible study, and a small group of people, probably 15 people. Kind of fun doing that stuff because you get to have some real fellowship. So tonight's the same thing. Tonight, let's break open the Word. Tonight, let's have fellowship. Tonight, let's have, if you will, a Bible study, and let's just talk about the words, if you will, of Jesus, because I'm fascinated always with the words of Jesus. As I mentioned to you, this, if you will, in the last two verses of the 9th chapter of Matthew, in the 10th chapter of Matthew, is the first missionary journey ever in the New Testament. This is where Jesus sends for the very first time his disciples out, and he tells them what to do and how to do it and what to expect. And it's just really becoming an amazing thing. They go out, by the way, and they do what God has them to do, and they're just blown away by the power of God that they themselves have expressed. Why is it in the Bible? I mean, who really cares? Why is it preserved for thousands of years for you and I to look at? By the way, it's not just preserved for thousands of years for you and I to look at. It's preserved at human cost. People laid their life down. Blood was shed by Christians before you so that you tonight can hear the words of Jesus. Are we talking about a story? Absolutely. But we're talking about a whole lot more than just a Sunday school story. We're talking about the heartbeat of God. We're talking about the character and nature of God that's found in the Word of the Lord. And when you go to the character, nature, and God of God, and you pull it out and you apply it in your life, it changes the world around you. Just like you saw the video, if you will, of Reuben. How all of a sudden he didn't even understand what was going on, but there was a softening in his heart. And that softening in his heart brought him to a place of making a commitment to Christ. And then today he works in our children's church teaching children. And his brother is a youth pastor. It all started that he went from a punk to a preacher because something happened on the inside of him. The powerful presence of God's word really does something for all of us. So when we come to church, it's not a time to fall asleep. It's not a time to get bored. And if you're falling asleep and you're bored, you need to get saved. You're the bottom line, you're just not saved. And you're going to die and go to hell. So you might as well just wake up and listen closely. Somebody needs to tell you that, because you're not coming in this place falling asleep and daydreaming and think you're going to get by with God. He reads the heart. So if you have to knock two teeth out with your right cross across your face to keep you awake tonight, it'd be better to knock your teeth out than to die and go to hell. Is anybody listening? Because if you maintain that attitude, you couldn't possibly have a real relationship with God. Couldn't possibly. And God said, you know them by their fruit. And so if there's not the fruit of at least desire to get more of God, can I tell you something? You're a mess, but we'll take care of it before the night's over. Somebody say amen. Amen. Starts in Matthew, the 9th chapter. Jesus is called, if you will, and speaking to his disciples in the 37th verse. And he says to his disciples, the harvest truly is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into the harvest. Now, when you read that, you can understand what he's saying. He says, look, there's a lot of people out there that want to know about Jesus. There's a lot of people out there that need to know about the kingdom of God. A lot of people out there need to know about God. There's so many people out there, and they're really hungry. And there's a tremendous harvest out there. But the laborers are few. Can you imagine having a great, if you will, farmland? And let's say you had hundreds and hundreds of acres of the most beautiful crop you could possibly ever imagine. Can you imagine the wheat fields or the grain fields or the corn fields of acre after acre, and it's just ripe and it's perfect and it's beautiful. The rain and the weather has been perfect, and all of a sudden it's time to pick. And you know if you don't pick in a certain period of time, you're going to lose the crop and it won't be any good at all. And there's no laborers to come and help take that crop away. What a shame. It's probably has to be one of the greatest disappointments in a farmer's life is not being able to harvest the hard work that he's done. And here's God, creator of the heavens and the earth, and knows that there's a hungry mass of people out there and there's no laborers to handle them. What a shame. So someone might come along and say, what's my purpose? Here's the purpose. Sometimes God wants to build you particularly to be the laborer. In fact, it's interesting as we read the 9th chapter, verse 37, 38, that I just read to you, he says, pray. Notice the words again. He says, therefore, verse 38, pray. He's not asking them to go. He's not asking them to do anything. He's asking them to simply pray. And all of a sudden you find in verse number 1 of the 10th chapter, after they've prayed, the very next verse, they're the answer to their own prayer. They're the ones. They prayed, God, send somebody. And then God says, you're it. Today I was preparing for tonight. In the second service, I was in the first service yesterday, first service this morning, and then second service, I came in, made announcements, and then went out and was doing all the overheads that you see so that the people would be able to follow us with the verses up on the overheads. And I did that during the second service, and I'm seeing this. The harvest is great. I need laborers. And I started, as Pastor Dan was in his altar call, I walked up to the back and I came out into the foyer. And a lot of guys, you don't know this, but there's a lot of people in the foyer during church service. I Don't know why they don't come in, but they don't. They sit there, they listen, they peek through the glass of the doors, they walk around. I don't know what it is, but there's a lot of people out there. And I look in the courtyard, there's a lot of people in the courtyard with their Bibles open and studying the Word of God, listening at the speakers that are in the courtyard. And as I walked into the foyer, I saw these people in there, and I just started to walk up to them, and I just said, hey, I just didn't care. I just read these verses, and I was kind of fired up on the inside about doing something, and I just was going to be bold. Instead of just saying, hi, how are you? God bless you. Good to see you. I grabbed each person I could get a hold of and said, come on, you want to go down and get saved? I'll go with you. And it was really funny because two or three of them said, no, not now, but maybe next week, you know. But boy, they got out of my sight real fast. They, you know, as soon as my back was turned, they were gone. But there were three that literally said, yeah, I want to go. And they were looking through the glass or they were standing there watching the television. And so I brought them in. And they came down. I said, just go on down there. I'll go with you. No, you don't have to. I'll go. And they just went. I mean, they didn't hear the message. They didn't hear anything. They just wanted somebody to help them get from there to here. I mean, it's that simple. And you know, you stop and you think about it. In our world, every one of us have a world that we live in. There's somebody around us all the time, grocery store, at the coffee counter at job, you know, in the lounge at the work, people you work with, people that are in trucks and cars, and people that you talk with during the day in the gas stations, and wherever you might possibly be, there's people around you. Did you know those people are just wanting somebody to help them get to where they need to be? They may not even know it, but deep down inside, they want to get right with God. And the reason they're not getting right with God, they don't know how to get right with God, and they don't even know they have to get right with God. So they're kind of like been tricked by everybody out in the world telling them, you know, they all act like idiots together. So therefore, everybody is an idiot, so they think they're normal, when in fact, they're really not normal at all. They want to get into a place of a relationship with God, and the laborers are very few. That statement has not changed. And really one of the purposes of a church is just to get you to a place. And you know what? I made a statement earlier tonight. I said these words. Listen, I said, it's amazing to me how many people have come through our children's church that are now preachers. Children. Children. I mean, you guys bring your children. Did you know that some of you will have children that are preachers of the gospel, possibly all over the world? The same children you're bringing are going to preach the gospel. Let me tell you something. You cannot hang around this place without getting fired up for Jesus. This is a different kind of a church. I'm sorry. I mean, you know, some people say that's offensive to them. I don't give a flip if it is offensive, because I can't read anywhere in the Bible where it says lukewarm Christianity is acceptable. I can't read anywhere in the Bible that you just get by because that's what you do. You just get by until you live and until you die, until you go to heaven. Can I tell you something? That's not what happened with his disciples when he starts to talk to them. In the very first verse, the 10th chapter, pop it up for me. Listen to what he says. He says, and when he had called his 12 disciples to him, can I just say this to you? When God called you to him, he had a plan for your life. And some of you don't know what that is, and I don't know what it is either. You can come up and ask me, what's the plan that God has for my life? I know one of it, part of it is to you to get the Word of God so that you're so strong in the Word of God, you are hot for the things of God. Man, when you're burning for the things of God, when I was a young preacher, people would come to church. They wouldn't come to church to hear the Word of God. They just wanted to see some radical guy in the pulpit area whose veins were popping out and his face was bright red, spitting all over everybody. They said, man, you got to go see that guy. He's like, that's all it was. I was on fire, you know, and that's just the way it was 40 years ago. Just on fire. My Deborah's still on fire. My goodness, we have coffee every morning. She perks my coffee. I don't just throw it in the cup and hang around her. It'll start bubbling in a little while. You know, it's just amazing. So he calls them, and he's called you, and he's called me to himself. And he didn't say, listen, I want you to be passive. I want you just go do something. That's just like so stupid. Very first thing before he even tells him what to do is he gives him something. And tonight, maybe some of you need this. Listen to this. He says he gave them power. You know, he doesn't say, I just want you to be a Christian when I go on, be with the Lord. I want you to be a nice person. I want you to go get some candles in a building and light them, you know, and I want you to get some incense and blow it all over people. And I want you to wear a big old ecclesiastical robe with a big cross around the front of it and spread the love. I'm here to tell you something. God didn't do that. And I'm not saying that's bad, and I'm not here putting it down and making fun of it. Believe me, I'm not. But I am making this statement that that is something we cannot stop with, nor accept as that's the plan of God. When the very first thing he does is he gives them power. And that power is what you and I need to overcome in every area of our life. Are you listening to me? Without that power, we become a traditional ceremonial ritual gathering that is going to do nothing but blow smoke. And when in fact you and I need the power of God to get the job done that God wants us to do, there's a plan. Listen, if it's just raising your kids, you're going to need the power of God. If it's just witnessing your mom and dad, it's going to need the power of God. If it's just going to be somebody who's going to go a little further in life than you can go by yourself, you're going to need the power of God. One of the things that God does is he associates with his disciples his power. And he's not stingy with it. He says he gives them power. And then listen to the areas that he gives them power. Verse number two, unclean spirits and to cast them out. I'm sorry, verse number one, let's go back there. He says, unclean spirits to cast them out and to heal all kinds of sicknesses and all kinds of disease. Man, these guys were miracle working power. Now, someone will say, yeah, but that's the disciples of those days. Well, what the heck are you, Mickey Mouse? What am I, Mickey Mouse? You know, is there not problems today? Are there not people that need Jesus today? Is there not a harvest even greater today? In other words, God says with that power is going to come a sign to the unbeliever that God is present in his house. Don't ever lose the power of God in the church. And he comes on in verse number two and he makes this statement, which I found fascinating. Now the names of the 12 apostles were these. First Simon, who was Peter, and so on and so on and so on and so on. Listen, let me just talk to you just for a moment. One time I heard a great man of God, and I'm talking about one of the most world famous Bible teachers that you can ever imagine. I studied for 7 years under this guy, 8 hours a day. And he was one of the greatest Bible teachers. But all of a sudden, when he would teach stuff, something would hit me on the inside that said, that's not right. And there was more than once that went off on the inside of me, that's not right. Don't listen to him in that area. It was like I was getting trained by one of the greatest Bible teachers in the world. That's the Holy Spirit, not just a man. And this man made a statement. He started going through the names of these disciples. And he started explaining, this one's a tax collector, and this one had this kind of personality, and this one had this and had this. And he started mentioning some of the qualities, if you will, of these people. And most likely Jesus saw him and, you know, took him in as a disciple because he was this kind of a person. And I want you to know something. When I heard that, a bomb went off on the inside of me. A bomb went off and God spoke and said, that's not true. That these disciples were selected. These disciples were selected. Let me say it again. These disciples were selected because they were a mix of the common. There was everything there. There were tax collectors, which were bad guys. There were fishermen. There were workers. There were boat people. There were repair people. There were probably people that labored in the fields. You know what they were? They were a conglomerate of people that were common people, just like you and me. God has a history of taking common people like you and like me and doing something great. Numerous times the Bible says that in our weakness, he makes us strong. He's looking for somebody that can't make it, and he gets in the inside of them by their heart, and they make it big time. If you cannot make it, you're a perfect candidate for God to use if you let God use it. Come on, somebody. In 1 Corinthians, I love this word. In 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, verse number 27, I'll just pop it up on the overhead for you. 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, verse number 27 says, but God has chosen the smart and the rich and the educated and the brilliant, the talented and the gifted. Does your Bible say that? Doesn't say that at all, does it? See, God has chosen. Wait a minute. What has God chosen? He chose that tax collector that everybody wanted to beat the snot out of. He chose that rude fisherman. He chose that guy that had a farm. He chose that guy that was agricultural. He told that rancher how to, he told all of these guys had qualities, and the qualities they had is they had a heart for God. And in having a heart for God, they come under the category of this verse. May I ask you, is that you tonight? May I ask you, is everybody in here tonight, listen to me, you don't think God can ever use you, just like Reuben never thought God could ever use him. Reuben never even thought he could even get saved. He didn't even know what the heck he was coming to church for. He just kind of hung around somebody that was bringing him to church, and all of a sudden, man, today he's preaching the gospel. And the whole point of this is that God takes the foolish things. He has called people. Listen, if you think you're foolish and don't know anything, you're a candidate for greatness. Is that bizarre? Listen to this. God has chosen the foolish things of this world to put to shame the wise. And God has chosen the weak things of this world to put to shame the things that are mighty. So if you're foolish and weak, you're a candidate for greatness. So you say, well, what do I do? How do I have to do this? You're going to have to chase after God. People, I've found that chase God. Let me say it again. Over the years, 40 years of being a theologian, I found some things out that are true. You listen to me now, just for a second. Grandpa's talking to you. You never had a grandpa ever tell you anything godly. So listen as Grandpa talks to you and you'll be prosperous. Over 40 years, I found out that people who chase God get blessed. I mean, beyond their wildest dreams, get blessed in every area of their life. And if you're saying to yourself, I want to be blessed, I'm here to tell you, but you don't think you can measure up. Can I tell you something? The moment you say, I can't measure up, you now become a candidate that can be blessed. Because all you have to do is chase God. He'll do the rest. Somebody ought to give me a great big amen. Let's jump down to verse number 5 of the 10th chapter. In these 12, Jesus sent out and commanded them. So all of a sudden, he's telling them what to do. And what he tells them to do is really fascinating. I found this, you know, to be something really fascinating. Because he's about ready to say something that's important. Verse number 5, he says this, do not go to the way of the Gentiles. Wait a minute, I'm a Gentile. This is Jesus who went to the cross. And now he's telling his disciples, don't have anything to do with the Gentiles. Doesn't make sense. Then he comes along and he makes a statement also in the same verse. He says, do not enter into the city of the Samaritans. Doesn't make sense. Samaritans weren't Jews. Half in, half out. And how we find something taking place here. Number one, Jesus had not yet died for everybody. He was still under the law. Are you following me? No one had gone to the cross. No one had yet paid the price. His blood hadn't been shed for the world yet. And now he makes the wisest statement in the world. Can I tell you what the wise statement is? I love Jesus because he makes these kind of wise statements. He says to his disciples, listen, don't go to the Gentiles and don't go to the Samaritans, because if you do, you'll turn off the Jew. Because the Jew says, we're not having anything to do with Gentiles, nothing to do with Samaritans. And if they see you going there, they'll have nothing to do with you. Because it's not time yet for him. Complete, total wisdom is our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And he's not afraid to put it in scripture so you and I can learn that the God that we serve is a God of power and a God of wisdom and knows how to make a plan come to pass. Because in our stupidity, we would run to everybody and turn half of them off because he hadn't yet gone to the cross. Boy, does God know what he's talking about. He says these words, goes on in verse number 6. And I love this. He says, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. In other words, he confirms it. It's not about the Gentiles yet. Their day is going to come. Their time is going to come. And boy, hasn't it. Thank God. The dispensation is going to take place. It's not about the Samaritans yet. But what's coming right now that's before us is the lost sheep of Israel. And I want you to know something. Oftentimes, God will put people in front of you and you will labor and labor and labor for somebody and it's just not their time. Sometimes you have to understand that someone plants a seed and then someone reaps a harvest. And you may be in that time of planting a seed in someone's life and be frustrated because you don't see the harvest. But I'm here to tell you, those people that walked down that aisle today were people that somebody, somewhere, at some time told them about Jesus and they were here at church. They didn't know how to get through those doors to get down here. But when they came because somebody planted a seed. You may be a seed planter tonight. You may be a seed placer tonight. You may just have a bumper sticker on your car. But I'm here to tell you, somebody planted the seed in Reuben's life for Reuben to come into this house of God. Someone planted a seed for the preachers in this place for somebody to finally get to a place of being a preacher. The seed was planted and the harvest is coming. And God knows the timing of everything. And you can't, and I can't judge that, because if I judge this on the words that I just read, that would have confused me. It did when I was a young Christian. I didn't understand it until the Holy Spirit said, Jesus couldn't go to those people. He would have never had an opportunity to go to the lost sheep of Israel if he went to those people. Wow, I was just amazed at how much God is in control. Verse number 7. And as you go, he says, preach. Tell somebody. Show your life and show, open your mouth. So simple. You don't have to beat anybody up with things of God. Can I tell you something? Beating people up doesn't get the job done. Walking in the love of God does get the job done. And show them, I mean, be loud preacher by showing them your life. That's the greatest preaching you can ever do, is show them your life. You don't have to go beat them up with the word of God or anything. That'll come in time when they're going to get to the place where they need to learn the word of God. But here he makes this statement, and it's a great statement in verse number 7. He says, and go preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven, this is such a fascinating word, is at hand. Is at hand. What the heck does that mean? That means you can take it if you want. It's there. Everybody says, I want the kingdom of God. Well, then take the kingdom of God. It's at hand means it's so close you can take it. And one of the things about God, he doesn't hold back the kingdom. He says, it's so close, you can take it. But it all comes down to what you take. What your choices are. I talked to some people in the foyer. They said, no. They got red-faced. They said, next week maybe. I said, okay, maybe I'll come. I'm preaching next weekend, so I'm not going out there before I run out there while you guys are in here. Hey, I remember I'm being a... Maybe one of you will do it. And go get them right from the foyer. If they don't like it, they won't come back. Who cares? But we planted a seed. You know? Hey, you want to go down? I'll go with you. Go down, what does that mean? Give your heart and life to Jesus. Well, maybe next week. Okay. See, they weren't ready. But there was those that were ready and just needed a little encouragement and a little help. And guys, can I tell you something? It's at hand. Everything with God and everything God has is at hand. He doesn't hold back anything. He's ready to give you his power. You got to take it. He's ready to give you his ministry. You got to take it. He's ready to get, you got to take it. It's at hand. You know, if I threw a $100 bill down and I said, the first person that comes and takes it, you would clean the aisles getting up here. Guess why? Because it's at hand. And you won't get it until you take it. You had to get out of your seat, knock four people over to get up here to get the $100 bill. Don't care about being rude. I'll pray for you later, brother. Get the $100 bill. But how'd you get the $100 bill? You had to fight your way to get it. And God says it's at hand. What will you make a choice to get? Your call, not mine. Guy's call in the foyer was next week. Some call in the foyer said, I'm ready. Your call. The king, he says, go tell them right now. They can have God right now is what he says. They can have all of God. You can have his love. You can have his power. You can have his mercy. You can have his grace. You can have his kindness. You can have his blessings. You can have him open doors that no man can open and close doors no man can close. That's God. And it's waiting for you right now. And it's at hand. You got to take it. Jeez. So cool. He just tells them something that's amazing. It's at hand. Some of you have been wanting God to do something for you. It's at hand. You got to take it. Some of you said, I want to be blessed. Listen, here's how. Go take it. Find out what it takes to get blessed and do it. Get out of the seat, knock four people over to get the blessing. That's what happens. That's simple as that. Is anybody listening? I'm on verse number 8. Heal the sick and cleanse the lepers and raise the dead. Cast out demons. Let me stop you right there. How do I do that, Pastor? I don't know how to do that. It's weird. You know, you don't know how to do it. You don't do it. God does do it. Do you remember verse 1? He gave them power. I love this. In Zechariah 4 and 6. I don't know, you guys, can you pop that up for me, Zach? 4, 6. And it says this. And he says, this is the word of the Lord of Zerubbabel. Do not by might, not by power, but by my spirit. In other words, how are you going to do all those things? Go back with me to verse number 8. Will you put that up again for me? Cleanse the lepers, raise the dead, cast out demons. How am I going to do that? That's weird. Man, I just wanted to go to church and sing a few old songs, listen to a few nice things, and I come in here and you're really bothering me tonight because you're really saying, boy, there's something I don't know how to do that. I'm afraid to do that. Of course you are. You don't know how to do it. That's why you need the power of God. When you got the power of God, you can go do that. Guess what? You might be just planting the seed, but somebody else will reap the harvest. Do something. And he comes along and he makes this statement. He says, freely have received and freely give. Deborah and I have preached all over the world. There's very few times. And I'll just say this. I'm not saying to brag. Because of that verse, it's cost me a lot of money. You said, what do you mean? Cost you a lot of money. Because when you go preach someplace, you get all these offerings. I mean, I think I've taken about 4 offerings in my whole life. One was a really, really big one. In fact, I looked at the guy and said, do you want me to come back next week? It was $25,000 for a 45-minute message. And that was 10 years ago, 12 years ago. And I went, oh, man, there's money in this ministry. Except I remember that verse. Freely you received, freely give. It's not about money. This is not about getting. It's about giving. I already got when I got Jesus. I already became rich when I had Jesus. I already became one of the wealthiest people on the planet when I got Jesus. I don't need somebody in some little church giving me something. Now, I'm not saying I'm trying to be arrogant or pompous or I don't need it. Of course, all of us. But this is what Jesus said. His disciples are going to go do something. Now, you can go do what you want to do. Maybe you're a preacher in here and you're going out and ministering and people give you offerings. God bless you. We love you. We're going to give you a big offering if you're in our pulpit too. This is just the way it is. But for me personally, that verse jumped off the page and never has left my life. And Deborah's the same way. I keep expecting her. She traveled around the world 2 times in 1 year, preaching all over the world. I kept expecting her to bring home the bacon. She brought home the box. Empty. Because she'd give it back. I ended up paying for the trip. Ended up paying for her airfare. Ended up paying for all the bills. And so I'm like, this really stinks. Could you bring some? It's because her heart's there. Freely. And when you have that kind of heart that you want to give more than you receive, man, you're a minister of God. Are you following me now? Come on, somebody. The next verse comes along, verse number 9. I'm going to finish up here. I might just provide neither gold nor silver nor copper in your money belts. In other words, you don't need to do that. Why would I not want to take something? Why? What's this all about? This is my first missionary journey. How am I going to eat? How am I going to, where am I going to live? How am I going to provide for myself? You're sending me out to do this? Oh my goodness. Verse 10. Nor bag for your journey, nor 2 tunics or your sandals, nor is it the worker is worthy of his food. And that word worthy is such a cool word. It means this: one who is esteemed for their effort. Oftentimes we don't give worthy honor to people who have made a great effort, esteemed in their effort, is the word worthy. When he says a worker is worthy of his food, in other words, he should be esteemed for what he brought to someone's life, which happens to be, listen to this, the kingdom of God that is at hand. Verse number 11. Now, whatever city or town that you enter, inquire who in it is worthy. And in other words, esteemed for his effort. And stay there until you go out. Verse 12. And when you go into the household, greet it. See the words greet it? What we think is, hi, how are you? That's our kind of greeting. It wasn't their kind of greeting. Their greeting was bestowing blessings. When he says greet it, that means you're going there and you're saying, bless this house, peace upon this house, wealth and riches upon this house, upon your children, upon your life, bless it. And that's what he was doing. He was pronouncing a blessing. That's the greeting of this period of time. Verse number 13 says like this: if the household is worthy, esteemed you are because of its effort, he says, let your peace come on it. In other words, bless them. But if it is not worthy and they don't esteem you for what your effort is, he says, let your peace return to you. Get up and get out. So many times we meditate on this. In other words, there's a time coming when some of them will fail at what they're doing. The first time we fail, we want to quit. And I want you to know something. When you confront people about the kingdom of God, there will be a time when you feel like you have failed. Stop thinking that and remember, maybe you just planted the seed that's going to come to pass 10 years from now. The guy will never get it out of your mind. I'll never forget a guy who planted a seed in me. One time he came to my office. He worked for us in Beverly Hills as I was a vice president of an insurance company as a young man, 20 years old. And he said these words to me. He said these words. He says, you know, you need to be born again. I said, what's born again? I didn't know what it meant and all that stuff. And he started explaining to me. I said, I've got my own religion. Let's don't talk about religion. Keep that. I remember my dad said, keep your religion on Sundays. So I said it to him. Keep your religion to yourself, out of the office. Keep it on Sundays. It tormented me, what he said. Just those words. I'll never forget the guy as long as I live. It tormented me. It was over and over. You must be born again. Jesus said, you must. And I went, and I went, and I went, and over and over and over. Sometimes you're going to greet people. They're not going to appreciate what you have to say. They're not going to esteem you worthy of listening to you. They're going to reject what you have to say. But the seed, you've got to believe, has been planted, and the harvest is going to come. Today I stand before you because of that guy that planted a seed in my heart. In my office on Beverly Hills on Wilshire Boulevard. Right there. That's where he planted the seed. And I couldn't get away from it. Until about 6 months later, I ran back to him and I said, hey, man, I want you to know, I got born again. I asked Jesus in my heart. He said, great, let's have lunch. And I told you the story from there. Went to a Jewish delicatessen. He starts to pray out loud in a solid Jewish delicatessen in Beverly Hills. Oh, Jesus, bless this food. And I'm sweat balls are coming down on my face. And I sweat through my clothes, you know. And it's so embarrassing. And I wasn't yet mature enough to understand. Now today, guess what? It's a different story. My point being is this, my friends, is that there's going to be times when you need to return and realize you didn't make it. Listen to what he says, verse 14. Verse 14, he says this, and whoever will not receive you, nor hear your words when you depart from the house or the city, shake the dust off your feet. Why? Because here, this is the saddest verse in the Bible. Ready? Verse 15. Verse 15, assuredly I say unto you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah. More tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah got nuked. They're dust, man. But it's more tolerable for them, listen to this, in the day of judgment than for that city. It's a sad thing when people turn from the kingdom of God that's at hand. Tonight, it's just a word of encouragement. I want to do something, two things. Number one, before we finish, I want to make sure everybody's saved. You really are right with God. That's number one. Number two, I want to take the last few minutes and have you come if you need just a refilling of the power of God because it just drained. I remember I was telling John and Marie today, the first person I ever prayed for as a young preacher, first person died. They weren't even supposed to die. And I thought, man, I need to stop praying for people. I was ready to give up. Some of you have been ready to give up and give up because the power that God gave you has been going everywhere except for the things that you know you need to do. And today, let's renew that power of God. Some of you need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. It comes with the Holy Spirit. It comes with the power of God. But first, let's deal with this one issue. You haven't yet given God all of your heart. Come on, you know who you are. And you haven't yet given God all of your life, then somebody needs to love you enough, respect you enough, and honor you enough to tell you the truth. Listen to me. Listen, listen, listen. You're not going to make it, and you're going to die and go to hell. And I love you enough and respect you enough to tell you the truth. Tonight, it's not a coincidence that you're here. Tonight, this is an encounter with God. He brought you here so that you would give God all of your heart, give God all of your life, be born again. And you got to give it to him because he's not a thief to rob it from you. It's your call. Listen to me now. You'll love this. It's your choice. But you need to make that choice once and for all to give him all of your heart and all of your life. And I want you to know something. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. It always has been, it always will be. All are you listening? All or nothing. I'll prove it to you. Last book in the Bible, the book of Revelation, you've heard of it. Jesus said, I'm coming again. You know he is. We just don't know when, but he said, I'm coming. And he says, and when I come, I better find you hot or I better find you cold, because if I find you lukewarm, I will vomit you from my mouth. In other words, I'll spit you out of my mouth. You won't be able to make it. You're going to lose. You're going to fail if you're lukewarm. What's lukewarm? Let's cover that. It's a little in, a little out, a little up, a little down, talk to prayer. Hey, how about this? Here's lukewarm. You're not against God. Mm-mm. But you're not wholehearted for God. You're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. That's lukewarm. And some of you that are in here, you're not against God, but you're not wholehearted for God. And you think you're saved because you know about Jesus on the cross and you know about Christmas. But even the devil knows about Jesus on the cross and he knows about Christmas. So guess what? You can't get saved by what you have in your head. It's about what you've done with your heart. Have you given him all of your heart? Come on, you know, whether you've made that commitment or not, have you given him all of your life? Somebody is talking into your life. Grandpa's speaking to you right now, and you need to hear these words. And give God all of your heart, give God of your life. It's an all or nothing relationship with Jesus Christ. Always has been, always will be. God forgive us in American churches, we've watered that down. I tell you, this place would be a completely different place if we didn't water it down for 250 years in America. But we've watered it down. That's why we have two foolish candidates running for president. Because guess what? We watered it down. Now we can't have anything good except him, Jesus. And it's made that way in the first place. Tonight is your night to give God all of your heart and give God all of your life. If you haven't done it, guess what? I'm going to just pray with you. And if you want to be involved in that prayer, you want to be absolutely prayed with, I'm here to tell you we're going to do that. And if you're saying to me, Pastor, if you're going to pray for salvation, I want to be involved in that prayer. I want you to cover me in that prayer. We promise we'll do that. But I got to know who you are and where you're at. So I'm going to give you a moment of privacy, every head bowed and every eye closed. Come on, everybody, stop looking at me. Oh, you're still looking at me. Come on, close your eyes. And anybody that wants to be included in that prayer of salvation tonight, I just want you, nobody's looking and nobody will see this, so man, you couldn't get any more private than this, that tonight is your night. All I want you to do, in a moment, I'm gonna count to three and pop my hands together. It'll sound like this, bang. When you hear that sound, bang, your hand goes up. If you've been running from God instead of to God, get ready to put your hand up. If you've never given him all of your heart, get ready to put your hand up. If you've never given him all of your life, you know who you are, get ready to put your hand up. Or if you're in this place and you're saying to yourself, I'm just not sure where I'm at with God. Boy, I tell you, I'm just not sure. Then make sure tonight is your night of salvation. I'm going to count to three right now. It's your call. Everybody's heads down. Everybody's eyes closed. You pop your hand up if you want to be included in that prayer. Here it is. One, two, three. Let me see your hands. Let me see your hands in this place. There's one. There's two. There's three, four, five, six, seven, eight. Thank you. Anybody else? Real quick. Just get your hand up. Anybody else? There's eight wise people. There's nine. Thank you. God bless you. You put your hand up. Over on this side, I don't see anybody over here. 10. Thank you. 11. Thank you. Anybody else? Anybody else? There's another one. Thank you. God bless you. I think I got you all. I think I got you all. God bless you. You want to be included in this prayer? Okay, there's another one. Thank you. Here's what I want you to do real quick. Everybody that raised your hands, now you're going to have to do something. The kingdom of God is at hand. You're going to have to get up and take it. And if I had gold bricks up here and said you can have them if you come up, you would run up here. But I got something better than gold bricks. I got Jesus. And you can have him. I want you to get a hold of your coat, purse, sweater, Bible friend. If you raised your hand, or if you didn't, but you know you should have, and you want to be included in that prayer, I want you to get your stuff. Tap your neighbor next to you. Say, come on, I'll go with you. Get in the aisle and meet me right here in front. Let's stand and welcome them as they come. If you raise your hand, you want to be included in the prayer, and you're not messing around with God, then get your stuff and get up here right now. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on. together. Come and give them a hand as they come. You can come. If you raise your hand, get up here. Stop, everybody. There is absolutely nothing in the scripture that says you have to be an undercover salvation Christian. Someone says, if you belong to the army of God, there's no secret service. No, there isn't. If you raise your hand, you're serious about God, you're going to have to do something. If God can walk the streets of Calvary, a beaten, bloody mess, while people spit at him and yelled at him for you, in a safe place like this church, you need to get out of your seat and you need to come up here. And I love you enough to not let you get away with that silly foolishness. If you raise your hand, you're serious about God, I'm going to have that song sung one more time. You get out of your seat if you're serious. In other words, it's not going to work. There's no secret service Christians. Get out of your seat and get up here. These people are bold enough to come up here. We give them a hand. And guess what? They are worthy, esteemed for what their effort is. And God sees that. If you're not going to make any effort, don't think for a moment you'll be worthy.
And I surrender all. And I surrender.
Thank God you guys have come. I'm excited about that. See this guy over here? His name is Pastor Joel. He's going to pray with you. Only takes a few minutes to let you come right back to the church service. While they're back there, get them filled with the Holy Ghost. They need the power of God. So today, do more than just pray. Pray for power for them. He'll let you come in. The people you came with will wait for you. No weird stuff goes on, I promise. I promise, okay? Just make a left turn. Follow Pastor Joel right over there. Come on, let's give them a hand.